سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد فإن خير الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدى هدى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. As has been announced, this session is dealing with the aftermath and what do we do after the month of Ramadan. And in reality, I think it's important for us to always be careful to look too far ahead when we're dealing with a task or job that is right in front of you. One of the things that will cause a person to lose the battle, to lose the competition, is when he's dealing or he should be dealing with something that's right in front of him, he should be focused on it 110%, he starts to think about something down the line. In the world of sports and athletics, this is one of the things they teach you. So anyone who has had any experience in organized athletics, if you make it to the playoffs, for an example, and there are multiple games, you have to take each game at a time. You can't look past the game that's right in front of you. And when you do that, a lot of times that'll cause you to lose the competition because you're misfocused. So Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned in the Quran, وَلَا تَقُلْ لِشَيْءٍ إِنِّي فَاعِلٌ ذَلِكَ غَدًا إِلَّا أَنْ يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ. Don't say I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that tomorrow, unless you say inshallah. So there is a level of having responsibility, planning for the future. We all have to plan. We all have to plan. As that cliche say, he who fails to plan, he plans to fail. So there has to be a level of planning for the future, no doubt about it. But when you're dealing with a task that is right in front of you and you are actively engaged in it right now, that's the task you have to give your total, absolute attention to. Because one of the tricks of a shaitan is to make your focus away from that thing, and then as a result of that, you lose the competition. We're in competition right now. Competition with ourselves, competition with each other, and we're in competition against the shaitan and rajim to get the most out of this Ramadan. So I don't want to look too far ahead, inshallah, but we will come to that, bi-idhnillah. What is the aftermath of Ramadan? What are the things that we do after Ramadan? Before getting to that, I want to bring to your attention, we're on the 27th day of Ramadan. Last night could have been Laylatul Qadr. And it appears, Allahu A'lam, that the 27th is Laylatul Qadr, although there are proofs that it could be the 21st, 23rd, 25th, or the 29th. It could be. But the companions, many of them, like Ubay ibn Ka'b, used to swear by Allah that it was the 27th. He used to swear by Allah. And other companions and other things were said. Like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam specifically telling the people, it is the 27th night. But he said when he came out to them, as you all know, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Uritu laylatul qadr thumma unsituha." I saw laylatul qadr and then I was forced to forget it. وَإِنِّي رَأَيْتُ نَفْسِي صَبَاحُهَا أَسْجُدُ فِي مَاءٍ وَطِينٍ. He said, and then I saw myself in a vision that I prayed the Fajr prayer, and I was making sajda in water and in mud. The narrator of that hadith from the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, his name is Unais. He said that the Prophet prayed with us Salatul Fajr that morning, and it had rained, and there was water on the ground. When the Prophet got up and he went in his house, he had some mud and water on his forehead, on his nose. He said, and the night before that was the 23rd night of Ramadan. The 23rd. So those people from the companions who say it's the 23rd, specifically, there's a Dalil. Those who say it was the 25th, they have Dalil. The companion who came and he said, Ya Rasulullah. During the last 10 days of Ramadan, I prayed with my companions in the desert. I pray with them in the desert. I'm the leader, I'm the imam, I pray in the desert. Tell me one day that I should not miss that could be Laylatul Qadr. If there was one day that I had to be in the masjid to be there for Laylatul Qadr, what day would it be? He said in the authentic hadith in Sahih Muslim, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, it is the 23rd. It is the 23rd. Make sure you don't miss the 23rd night. The 23rd night. The Prophet told him the 23rd night. So there are Dalils. 25th. He told us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that all of the books in a long hadith, he mentioned that all of the books have been revealed in the month of Ramadan. The Suhuf of Ibrahim, the Suhuf of Musa, the Torah, the Injil, the Zabur that was with Dawud. All of them were revealed on different nights in Ramadan. All of the Kutub. And he said that the Quran was revealed after 24 days passed from Ramadan. The Quran was revealed after 24 days passed from Ramadan, which shows Laylatul Qadr is the 25th. 25th. So the point is, we don't know when it is. So you have to take care of every day, which brings us to this particular point. As we're going to talk about, inshallah, what's after Ramadan, I say, hey, we better focus on what's in Ramadan right now. Many people believe that once we get to the halfway point, or once we get to the last 10 days, it's an upcline battle, and then the last 10 days, we level off, and now it's time to coast. A person who understands that is not understanding the true Ramadan, the Ramadan of the Sunnah. You know that hadith of Munkar al-Nakir, Man Rabbuka, Ma Deenuka, Ma Laqutta Fi An Hadha Ar-Rajul Ladhi Bu'itha Fikum. Who's your Lord? What's your religion? What do you have to say about that man who was sent? Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. When the Muslim is asked this question in his grave, Man Rabbuka, some Muslims who worship Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, some Muslims who worship Ali ibn Abi Talib, they worship dead people in the grave. Some Muslims who don't know who Allah is, what He does, what He doesn't do, where He is, what's His name, what's His attributes. Some Muslims, they know that Allah is the Rabb. They know that Allah is the Khaliq. They know that Allah is Raziq. But they don't know that Allah is Al-Ilah. Al-Ilah. The one who should be worshipped. Kuffar Quraysh, Abu Lahab, Abu Jahl, Umayy ibn Khalif, all of them knew that Allah was the Rabb, Allah was the Khaliq. وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتُمْ مِنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهِ. If you ask them, Ya Muhammad, Abu Lahab, Abu Jahl, if you ask these Kuffar Quraysh, who created the heavens and the earth, verily they're going to say, Allah. They know Allah. Prophet's father's name was Abdullah. They know Allah. But they didn't know that Allah was the Ilah, Al-Ilah. Al-Ilah is Al-Ma'bud, the one who deserves to be worshipped. Al-Shahid bin Al-Kalam, Wal-Qasd. Ma-Deenuka. What is your religion? What is the religion that the Prophet brought? How is the prayer? What is the zakat? What is the song? What is the hajj? What is the umrah? What is the hijab? What is the masjid? The one that he brought, not the cultural one. Not the one you think. Not the one you want to make. So a lot of people, we are fasting. But is it the Sawm of the Sunnah? A lot of people are fasting. But is it the fast of the Sunnah? Some people's tasawwur or their understanding of Ramadan, you struggle. At the beginning, you struggle. Last 10 days, it levels off. Some people will think you're going down. It's time to take your foot off the pedal, off the metal. You gotta take your foot off the pedal and you just coast now. They said about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, إذا دخل العشر الأواخر شد مئزره وأحيا ليله وأيقظ أهله. If the last 10 days came, he tightened up his belt. He became more serious. Tightened up his belt means he left his women alone. No relations. He didn't deal with them. He tightened up his belt. He prayed the night time. And not only that, but he woke his family up. He woke his kids up. He woke the people up from his ahl and bayt. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as one of the companions said, كَانَ يَجْتَهِدُ فِي آخِرٍ فِي عَشَرٍ أَوَاخِرٍ مَا لَا يَجْتَهِدْ فِي غَيْرِهَا. In the last 10 days, he made more efforts. He made more efforts than he did throughout the month of Ramadan. So where's this concept? Once you get there, you start going down. He did more in the last 10 days. He did more. Like that hadith. He made itikaf. The companions as well, Ridwanullahi alayhim. This Taraweeh that we're praying, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't give the companions a salat called a Taraweeh. In reality, it was the companion, Umar radiallahu anhu. We have a great debt of gratitude to Umar for many aspects of this religion. Many things in Islam were legislated because of Umar. May Allah be pleased with him. He came out one day and he saw the companions and they were divided in the month of Ramadan. Like you brothers are sitting over there, I'm going to ask you brothers to move up. And the reason why I'm asking you is this point right now. Umar came. He saw in the nighttime in Ramadan, some people were praying over there, seven people, some people over there, eight people, some people over there, three people. Some people over there, four people, some people over there, 12 people. And he saw this division amongst the Muslims. And Islam is a religion that commands the people to be together. It commands the family to be together. The individuals of the community to be together. And only the Quran and the Sunnah can bring us together. You look at this audience. This one's from Tanzania. That one is from Sudan. That one is from Mali. That one is from Pakistan. That one is from America. This one is a revert. That one is black. This one is an elder. That one is a lady. This one is a youngster. That one is educated. That one is unemployed. And there's all kinds of differences between them. Only Al-Islam has the ability, the Quran and the Sunnah, to bring all those people together. Only the Quran and the Sunnah. That's proven by the Prophet when he came, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he started giving da'wah, and he had all kind of people in front of him. And Allah Ta'ala revealed all of those ayats. وَاعْتَسِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا وَاذْكُرُوا إِذْ كُنْتُمْ أَعْدَاءً فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ فَاصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَتِهِ إِخْوَانًا وَكُنْتُمْ عَلَى شَفَا حُفْرَةٍ مِنَ النَّارِ فَانْقَذَكُمْ مِنْهَا كَذَلِكَ يُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ آيَاتِهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَهْتَدُونَ. He said in the Quran, hold on all together to the rope of Allah. And the Prophet said, the rope of Allah is the Quran. And do not be divided amongst yourselves. And remember your enemies one to another. And Allah brought your hearts together. And all of you were on the brink of the hellfire, about to fall in. But Allah saved you from it. And there are many ayat of the Quran like that. When the Prophet brought the Quran and the Sunnah, the companions listened to it, they practiced it, and then they united upon the Kitab and the Sunnah. It's the only thing. Allah told the Prophet ﷺ, لو أنفقت ما في الأرض جميعا ما ألفت بين قلوبهم. Ya Muhammad, if you spend everything in the earth to bring them together, you'll never be able to bring them together. You pay each one $100 million, £100 million, I'm going to pay each one £1,000, £100,000, just be united. That won't work. That will never work. Because some people work and live based upon principles, and there's not enough money in the world for you to pay that individual to go against this principle. But when he brought the Quran, he brought the Quran and the Sunnah united them. One Allah, one Ilah, Al-Wahid, Qul Huwa Allahu Ahad. One Qibla, one Qibla, one Quran, one Nabi, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, one Kaaba. When the Salah comes, one Imam, one Jama'ah. So Umar came, he saw all those people divided. He said, this is not nice. This is not nice. He got one of the ulama from the companions. His name is Ubay ibn Ka'b. He said, Ubay ibn Ka'b is going to be the imam, and everyone's going to pray behind Ubay ibn Ka'b. No more all of this stuff like that. The next day, Umar came out. He saw everybody was praying behind Ubay. Why Ubay ibn Ka'b? Because he was one of the four people that the Prophet told his companions, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, istaqilu al-Qur'an min arba'in. Learn the Qur'an from four of my companions. First one he mentioned, Ubay ibn Ka'b. Learn it from him. Rasulullah was praying one day, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he forgot an ayah. He forgot an ayah as he was reading. Why did he forget an ayah? قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. Tell them, I'm a human being just like you. The ayah said, سَنُقْرِئُكَ فَلَا تَنْسَ إِلَّا مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ. We will cause you to remember it so you won't forget it, except what Allah chooses. So the Prophet was reading and he forgot the ayah. He read and he left an ayah out. And then after that he realized. So after salat he said, Ya Aba Mundhir, Ubay ibn Ka'b. He said, were you in the salat with us praying? He said, yes. He said, why didn't you remind me of the ayah? Ubay ibn Ka'b said, I thought the ayah was abrogated, Ya Rasulullah. Maybe Allah abrogated it, that's why you didn't mention it. Meaning he was afraid to correct the Nabi of Islam. Maybe Allah took that ayah out. But the fact that the Prophet said to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Ubay, were you there? He asked him. Because he was from the ulama of the companions. He said, Ubay ibn Ka'b, in another hadith, what is the greatest ayah in the Quran? Ubay ibn Ka'b said, Allahu la ilaha illahu al-hayyul qayyum, la ta'khudhu sinatun. And he read Ayatul Kursi. The Prophet said, you have got away with all of the reward. Because that companion made his own ijtihad. Rasulullah didn't tell them at that point what was the greatest ayah. When he asked that man knew. He said the right thing. So the Prophet praised him for what he said. That goes to show his knowledge. So Umar chose him to be the imam over all of the companions. Umar came out the second day. He saw the people praying. He said, Ni'ma bid'ah hadi. This is a nice bid'ah. This is a new innovation. What did he mean by that? He meant the Prophet didn't do this, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet didn't put us behind one imam to read in the month of Ramadan. Had he done that, it wouldn't have been any need for Umar to do what he did. But Umar did it. But the Prophet said about Umar radiallahu anhu, as he said about the rest of those Khulafa Rashideen. The lady came and said, Ya Rasulullah, if I come and I don't find you, what should I do? Who should I go to? If I come and you're dead, you're not here, who should I go to? She said, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the two people after me, اقتدي بالذين من بعدي, Abu Bakr wa Umar. Look for Abu Bakr and then look for Umar. He said about Umar, لو كان نبي من بعدي لكان Umar. If there was a Nabi after me, it would have been Umar. He said, عليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين من بعدي. Follow my sunnah and the sunnah of the khulafa الراشدين. Abu Bakr, Uthman, and Ali. So when Umar did this, all of the companions saw him do it. All of the companions were there and they knew it. And not a single companion said, Umar, you can't do this. Don't do this. They all were in agreement. So this is from the religion. لَن تَشْتَمِعَ أُمَّتِي عَلَى الضَّلَالَةِ. He said, my ummah will never agree to what's wrong, especially his companions. So the companions, for your information, because a lot of masjids, a lot of Muslims, we don't know. In Ramadan, when they used to pray the Taraweeh in the time of Ubay ibn Ka'b, all throughout the lives of the companions did not, I repeat, they did not make the dua of Al-Qunut for 15 days. The companions left the Qunut. Allahumma ihdina fi man hadayt wa afina fi man afayt. They did not make this dua for 15 days. After 15 days, they made the Qunut for the rest of the time. Why? Because as I told you, the beginning of Ramadan is uphill. And then when you get to the 15th day, it's halfway over, you have to do more. And then you get to that point, you keep doing more. It goes to the last 10 days, you keep doing more. As for that thing, hey, it's time to rest? Nah. It's not time to rest. You have to keep on going. So the last point I wanted to mention before getting into inshallah, the aftermath of Ramadan, inshallah, is another very important issue. And that is the hadith of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that I remind myself of, I remind all of you of. And it is a principle you have to remember in your lives and you have to work by it. He says sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالْخَوَاتِيمِ. Your deeds will be judged by the last thing that you do. All of your deeds will be judged by the last thing that you do. So your life, whatever you die upon, that's going to determine where you're going, Jannah or Nar. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالْخَوَاتِيمِ. Remember this. The very last thing that you do will determine where you're going. Will determine. Is Allah pleased with you? He's not pleased with you. And everyone's going to find it easy to do what he's been created to do. So right now, the last thing that we're doing, we're in the masjid. We're giving a talk, giving da'wah. You're in the masjid, listening. We're fasting. You're leaving the masjid. You are going to visit a sick person. You're reading the Quran. You're making the dhikr. You have to make and sure that you're always engaged in doing something that is good. Because if you're smoking crack, smoking weed, if you're committing a crime, doing something, and you die on that, that's what you're going to be raised up upon. And there are many dalils for that, many proofs. Many, many, many proofs. Why did he say this hadith? إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالْخَوَاتِيمِ. He said it because of something happened with a companion or a man. The companions were fighting against the non-Muslims, and there was one man who was killing everybody up, and he was doing a good job killing everybody. And the companions were super amazed at how prolific he was and efficient he was in what he was doing. So when they broke to take time out and to rest, they said, Ya Rasulullah, if you would have only seen that man, he was really getting busy. Prophet Muhammad said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, innahu min ashab al-nar. That man is from the hellfire. The companions were shocked. They said, but we saw him killing all these people, making jihad, fi sabilillah. But when the Prophet said he's from the hellfire, not a single one of the companions said, nah, we're going to believe our eyes. We're going to believe what we saw and disbelieve what the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's what the people do today. If the hadith said this, the person say, nah, I know what my mind says, my culture says. Big scholar. For the last few years, he's been getting worse and worse and worse with the fatwas that he gives. He's the big mufti of the political Muslims in the world. Biggest political jama'at. They're everywhere. Main thing is the kursi. So he gets fatwas based upon what pleases the people. A hadith is inside of Bukhari Muslim. It said, if the fly goes into your drink, you have to push him down and take him out and throw him away. In one wing, there is sickness. In the other wing, there is the cure. That's what the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This man said, Wallahi, if a fly goes into our drink, we should throw the whole drink away. Because everybody knows that the fly, he lands on the defecation. He lands on the waste that comes out of human beings. The fly, he lands on dead animals. He lands on everything that's dirty and nasty, like maggots. So he's picking up a lot of germs. So if the fly goes into my drink, I'm throwing it away. Prophet Muhammad said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if the fly goes into your drink, push it down, take it out and throw it away. Who are you to say that? Who are you? This is how we are, liberal. We're very liberal. Companions weren't like that. A man came. He said, Ya Rasulullah, my brother, he has a stomach pain. Got problems in his stomach. Rasulullah said, go tell him to eat some honey. He went, told his brother, eat some honey. The pain persisted. He came back. Ya Rasulullah, he still has pain in his stomach, has a problem. He said, I told you, go tell him to eat some honey. He said, he told him to eat the honey. He came back, he said, it's still pain. Three times. After the third time, the man said, he still has stomach pain. The Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sadaqa Rasulullah wa kadhaba batulahi. I, the messenger of Allah, I told the truth. Your brother's stomach is lying. Maybe your brother's not eating that honey. You think he is, but something is wrong. As for me, I know what I'm talking about. And that's how the companions work. And until we get like that, you're not a complete mu'min. Right now, a person looks around, especially young people, he says, look at the Muslim ummah today. We're weak, we're oppressed. How is it that the future is to Islam and for Islam? Prophet Muhammad said the future is for Islam. That the Mahdi is going to come and all of this is going to be changed. Some people look at the world today and their eyes tell them, hey, I don't know about that hadith. No, you have to have yaqeen. Wallahi, you have to have yaqeen. If the Prophet said it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then that's what's going to happen. So one man said, okay, I'm going to keep an eye on him. So when they re-engaged the enemy, they were fighting, someone stabbed that man who was killing everybody previously. Someone stabbed him. So he was in pain, bleeding, and the wound was severe. He didn't have sabr. So he put his sword in the ground, stuck it in the ground, the sword was up. He threw himself on the sword and committed suicide. After the war, they told him, Ya Rasulullah, that man committed suicide. Prophet Muhammad says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna Allah la yansuru hadha ad-din bil-rajul fajir. Innama al-a'mal bil-khawatim. It is possible that Allah will and can assist his religion with an evil man. Verily your deeds will be judged by the last thing that you do. So that's two parts of the hadith. Allah can help this religion with an evil man. With an evil man, he's a non-Muslim, and he helps his religion. He wants to stand in solidarity and help the Muslims. Does that mean that we as Muslims now, we come and we do salat al-janazah for him because he stood for Islam? So if he dies, we're going to do janazah for him? We don't go overboard. We don't go overboard. The other thing about this man who was killed, obviously, he was from the Munafiqeen. You gotta know this. Because all of the companions, Allah said about them, radiyallahu anhum wa radu anhu. Allah is pleased with all of the companions. So some of the companions, they drink khamr. Some of the companions, they killed people. Some of the companions committed adultery. But they're all in Jannah. When he said that man is in the hellfire, you know automatically. He's a munafiq. He's not from the companions. Because all of the companions are in Jannah. All of them. As it relates to, and there are many proofs of that. If you make Umrah or you make Hajj. How many of you make Umrah or Hajj? Put your hand up if you make Umrah or Hajj. How many of you? If you perform Umrah or Hajj, there's this thing called the Talbiyah. لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك إن الحمد والنعمة لك لك والملك لا شريك لك. You say that a lot. Say that a lot. They call it the talbiyah. Prophet Muhammad says, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, anyone who dies performing Hajj or Umrah, and if you perform Umrah in Ramadan, you get the reward of making Hajj with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He performed Hajj during his life. When he came back to Medina, a lady said, Ya Rasulullah, I wasn't able to perform Hajj with you because we only had one horse. So if my husband was gone with you, we couldn't go. He said, when Ramadan comes, perform Hajj. You'll get the reward of when Ramadan comes, perform Umrah. You get the reward of making Hajj with me. He said, anyone who dies performing Hajj or Umrah will be raised up saying, Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik. Labbaik la sharika laka labbaik. It's a proof of what? You're going to be raised up doing the last thing you do. You're going to be judged based upon the last thing that you do. In the battle of Uhud, his uncle Hamza was killed. Shahada. Another companion, his name is Hanzala. Hanzala. Tremendous companion. Tremendous. Both of them. Both of them were killed at the war of Uhud. Hanbala, he was with his family having relationships, akramakumullah. When he heard that it's time for jihad, he was junub, he had janaba. He didn't even make a ghusl. He heard, okay, they're getting ready to get together and engage in the war. He got up and he ran. When he got there, they killed him. Prophet Muhammad said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the malaika gave him the ghusl. His uncle, Hamza, was killed. What did he do? Rasulullah wrapped them up, He did not give ghusl to any of them, and he did not wash any of them. So the person who was killed, fi sabilillah, as a shaheed, there's no janazah for him. No janazah. Nor is the ghusl given for them. They just wrapped up, and they left like that. He said that the angels, they cleaned, they washed Hamza and Hanbala. So even with janazah, there was no ghusl, no washing the body. He said, anyone who dies, fi sabilillah, will be raised up, and his blood will be like misk, coming out, that what he went through, the wound, is going to be oozing with the aroma and the smell of misk coming out. Adilio, whatever you die on, that's what you're going to be raised up on, whatever you're doing. If you are in a bad situation with your parents, and you die on that, and you allow this thing to exist, you die on that, that's what you're going to be raised up on. And there are many examples, but I got to move on. Many examples. I think all of you know the book we're dealing with, the 40th hadith of Imam An-Nawawi. We finished the first hadith. About the fourth hadith, fifth hadith, is the hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Verily, every one of you, your creation is brought together in your mother's stomach for 40 days as a sperm. And then for 40 more days as a leech-like clot. And then for 40 more days as a morsel of flesh. And then the angel is sent to blow into him the spirit of life. And then to write down four things. Writes down how much money he's going to make. Writes down his lifespan. Writes down, is he going to be happy or sad? Writes down, is he going to hellfire or going to Jannah? Prophet Muhammad said, Wallahi, a man will do the deeds of the people of paradise until only an arm span is between him and paradise. Meaning his death. He's in the masjid, he's doing all good, all this, this, and he gets close, and what was written for him overtakes him. And then he does the deeds of the people of hellfire, he dies, he goes into hellfire. And then another person does the deeds of the people of the hellfire, someone we know. She doesn't wear hijab, he doesn't pray, they're very bad in their behavior. When we look at them in the month of Ramadan, we say, A'udhu Billah, they do bad. It's not for you to be judgmental about them. Hate the action, but don't be judgmental. He's doing the actions of the people of the hellfire. And you are doing the actions of the people of Jannah, coming to the masjid. But you may be like that first man. I may be like that first man. May Allah save us. Don't be looking at people like that. And then what was written overtakes him. He does the action of the people of the Jannah. Like the people of Fir'aun, the magicians of Fir'aun. They were doing magic, misleading the people, and all that. And then when they took the dawah of Musa, they made sajda. Fir'aun killed them right after that. All they did was make sajda. They went to the paradise. Point is, there are many, many ahadith. Many. So therefore, what went past in the beginning of Ramadan, we made mistakes here, we made mistakes there. Don't focus on that. Focus on these last 10 days. Now the last 3-4 days. Focus on what remains. Don't worry about what happened before. Make tawbah for that. Focus on this. These last 10 days are what is going to determine, is your Ramadan accepted, not accepted? So now we have to get focused. So what do we do, inshallah, after Ramadan? There are a few things. Number one, we have to do the zakat al-fitr, because it's after Ramadan. You guys have to get serious about this zakat al-fitr. Everybody here. Abdullah ibn Abbas said, radiallahu anhu farada Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam zakat al-fitr tuhratin lissa'im min al-laghi wal-rafd wa tu'matin lil-masakeen. Rasulullah said that zakat al-fitr is wajib. Wajib. Fard. It is a purification for the faster. And it is food for the poor. This is important. Zakat al-fitr is wajib. It's wajib upon everybody. Pay attention to this now. I'm a father, I'm a husband. I have to pay zakat al-fitr for me. I have to pay zakat al-fitr to my wives. I have to pay zakat al-fitr for all of my children. All of my children who are living on the face of this earth. And they're under the age where they're not taking care of themselves. If they're old and they're married, the boy is married, the girl is married, it's not my job. If my wife has a baby in her womb, you don't have to pay zakat al-fitr on that. If a child died, you don't have to pay zakat al-fitr on that. Everybody, you have to pay zakat al-fitr. Everybody, you know zakat of your money, zakat, everybody doesn't have to pay that. Because not everybody has enough money to pay zakat. But zakat al-fitr, after Ramadan, wajib. So if you're married, you have to pay for yourself and your wife. Every child that you have underage. Anyone who's under your supervision, wajib. And what's the hikmah behind it? He said, "Tuhratun lis-sa'im." It is a purification for the one who is fasting. Min al-laghwi wa rafi, from the mistakes that he made. In this month of Ramadan, everybody here made mistakes. Everybody looked at what you shouldn't have looked at, said what you shouldn't have said, listened to what you shouldn't have said. You got upset, you got angry, you missed a prayer. Somebody here missed a wajib prayer, just didn't get up. So there is khalal and naqs. There's a problem in your fast. So therefore, you have to fix it up by zakat al-fitr. And the ibadat of Islam that are real long, that take a number of days, all of the ibadat that are very long, there's something to pay at the end of that ibadah from the wisdom of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And in the Quran, we have zakat, and we have Ramadan, and we have Hajj. Hajj is many days. And it's a lot of stuff you have to do. There's an ayat in Al-Hajj that tells us Allah wants you to slaughter an animal after you complete your Hajj. Slaughter the animal. لِتُكَمِّلُ so that you can complete the manasik. Because you made some mistakes in Hajj. You got upset, you complained, you did this, you did that. So you have to pay some money for that. Because it's long. Wisdom, Islam is not a joke. This is why it freaks me out when I see some people who don't know anything about this religion come in and they're opinionated about the religion. You opinion. You're minuscule. What are you talking about? You think Islam is open for any Tom, Dick, or Harry to jump into the arena and start talking? Jihad, jihad. You don't even know how to spell jihad in Arabic. You don't even know. And you're telling who's a kafir, who's a mubtadi, who's this? What are you talking about? Islam did not, Allah did not legislate a religion that is confusion. The legislation of Islam is tremendous, and it is hikmah. And also the zakat al-fitr, ikhwani, is for the help of the poor people. Last thing about zakat al-fitr is Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, they used to give the zakat al-fitr a day or 2 days before the salat. Prophet Muhammad said about zakat al-fitr, من أداها قبل الصلاة فهي صدقة مقبولة ومن أداها بعد الصلاة فهي صدقة من الصدقات. Anyone who pays the zakat al-fitr before the salat of Eid, then that is the zakat al-fitr, sadaqah, that will be accepted. Anyone who pays after the salat, then it's a sadaqah from the sadaqah. You didn't do what was right. And that's why we have the Eid al-fitr. Eid al-fitr, it should be delayed. After we pray Fajr, Eid al-fitr is delayed. Whereas the Eid al-Adha, after Fajr, it should be prayed as close to Fajr as possible. Wisdom in Islam. Not this folder that these people are upon. I'm a brand spanking new reaver. Abu Sam. I'm a brand spanking new reaver. Me. And then I'm going to tell people, Come to my house and learn the Quran, transliteration. How to read the Quran, transliteration. Come to my house. Come to my house and I'm going to teach you about fiqh. Come to my house, me, Abu Salam. I'm a brand spanking new Muslim. And I'm telling people, come listen to me. What do I know about the religion, me? What do I know? Abu Salam graduated from Medina, 8 years. Now, I'm going to say, ask me those big issues in this religion. I'm a mufti. I'm going to give you fatwas about. I'm going to say, no, man, I'm not doing that. Me trying to break my neck. I got to stand before Layomu Qiyamah, and I'm going to be held accountable for people's blood and people's private parts and the money because I was saying halal, haram. I'm going to stand before Allah before that? For that? Answer for that? I make people's private parts halal and haram. I'm the imam. Someone comes to me with someone's daughter. Comes to me with his daughter. They say, hey, I want to get married. I don't ask, where's the wali of the girl? I say, okay, let's get married. No problem. I marry him. Allah's going to ask me about that. Yom Qiyam. So the zakat al-fitr, the salat of al-eid, it is delayed to give people a chance to give the zakat to people. Zakat al-eid, the eid al-adha, right after fajr. To give people time to go slaughter the animal. That's going to take up time. Slaughter the animal and then get back to your families to have a good time. Wisdom, our religion. So do the zakat al-fitr. And you can distribute it 1 day or 2 days before the day that is due. The best thing is to do the zakat in foodstuffs. Because there's no problem. That's what the Prophet did. But there are some scholars that allowed you to give them money. Let the poor people buy what they want to buy. Especially if you know that they're responsible people. If you're going to give a poor person some zakat al-fitr, I have to give zakat al-fitr for 30 people. I'm responsible for 30 people. That's going to come out to a quite significant amount of money. I'm going to give him zakat al-fitr and he's going to go and buy a PlayStation. I'm not going to give him zakat al-fitr if I know that. I give him some rice. I give him rice, dates, barley, and give it to him like that. Because I did my job. Give it to the person who needs it. So don't forget the zakat al-fitr after the Ramadan. That's what we do. Another thing that we need to remind you of, inshallah azza wa jalla, is after Ramadan we have to attend the Eid. Some scholars said that praying the Eid is the sunnah. Some of them said it's fard kifaya. If some people do it, then the responsibility is off of the rest. And the majority of the ulama say that it's fardu ayn, it's wajib. In our culture, the Prophet ﷺ said, Munkar al-Nakir Darasin, Man Rabbuka, wa ma dinuka, what's your religion? In the religion of that person, the women never went to the masjid. They never went to the masjid for one reason or another. She wanted to hold classes in her house, so she never went to the masjid. This one, their culture, never go to the masjid. The culture, don't go to, even on a day to eat. There are some masjids that don't have facilities where the lady can come and get educated. And that's why when there's a janazah and someone dies, and now the women have to come to the masjid, they don't know what they're doing. She doesn't know she should come with wudu. She doesn't know when she gets in. She prays 2 rak'ah to the masjid to greet the masjid. She doesn't know the etiquette of the masjid. She'll sit there and pull out fingernail polish and she'll start doing her fingernails and her toenails. She doesn't know what's the etiquette of the masjid because the culture prevented her from coming to the masjid. But the masjid that is, you know, switched on, people know what they're doing, they're trying to teach the religion, practice the religion, they're going to educate the people. This is what we do in the masjid. So the Prophet told the women, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you women, everybody come to the masjid, everybody, even the woman who has her period, akramakum Allah, he said that. Even the woman who is on her period, come to the musalla, come out to pray. But then he told them, but let that lady stay away from the musalla. If you have your period, don't mix with the people in the line. Don't pray the prayer. That's what it means. Doesn't mean that the women who have their periods all have to sit under a special tree so everybody look at them, so they got it. Doesn't mean that. Not talking about that. It means that they don't pray in the line. They have to come out though. They have to come out. So some of you, and I'm going to mention this from the angle of I'm older than many of you. some like the Bangladeshi community. I'm not against any Bangladeshi, but you brothers who are here, you have to talk to your mother and talk to your sister. And you have to gather up the evidence and say, look, Ma, look, this is what the Prophet said to do. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I'm happy that last year at Bedford, I did the khutbah for Eid al-Fitr. And I think we did a sunnah that never was done here in Bedford. And that is, we went to the women and we said to the women, hey, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave the khutbah. He prayed, he gave the khutbah to the men. After that, he went to the women and he talked to the women. And he said to the women, hey, you women, ya ma'ashir al-nisa, tasaddaqna, give sadaqah. I see that you are the majority of the people of the hellfire. So that goes to show that the women should be addressed. And we did that last year. And the women, they came through and they spent their money like those companions did. So I'm happy that we had something to do with that. Even after Ramadan, there's still things we're trying to do to spread the sunnah, educate the people. So this year, inshallah, gonna have that same Eid. The Eid in accordance to the sunnah. You brothers who are the main brothers of this masjid, we always see you here. The volunteers, the ones who always bring in food. You brothers, we need you, especially younger brothers, we need you to volunteer to make that day a day that's possible. The best of you is the one who brings benefit to others. You know Green Lane? We had 70,000 people at the last Eid that I did. 70,000 people. We had to put up chairs for the old people. We had to put down things for them to pray on. It took a lot of logistics to put that thing together. So behind the scene, there were brothers and sisters working on that day, before that day. They went to the park. What they have to do, subhanAllah, 70,000. 2 years in a row. So now, we're not going to get 70,000 people for Bedford. We're not going to get 70,000. But still, there were a lot of people last year. MashaAllah. And we need you guys, we need you to come and to help. So offer your services so that we can make the Eid something that's really good for other people. And I told you this hadith the last time I was here. When the Prophet ﷺ was with his companions and he saw a commotion, he said, what's going on over there? They said, Ya Rasulullah, the people who are fasting on the journey, they were overcome and overwhelmed, and they fell out, they lost consciousness. And the people who were not fasting was giving them drink and fanning them. He said, the people who didn't fast, they ran off with all of the reward. You would think because you're fasting, you get all the reward. No. The ones who were not fasting, they got all of the reward because they were helping the other people. So, at the end of Ramadan, what do? You keep up the good works of trying to help people breaking their fast. In Ramadan, we were taught, break someone's fast, you get the reward. So people did that. Okay, after Ramadan, keep it up. Keep trying to help other people. We need you to volunteer. We need a number of you to volunteer. All right, so the Eid is important. We don't have time here today to go through the details of the Eid, but this is something, an ibadah. What's your deen? مَنْ رَبُّكَ وَمَا دِينُكَ. Some people, they say, I don't believe in the sunnah. Just give me the Qur'an. Just give me the Qur'an. And yet, the one who said that, she's saying to her, revert in Birmingham. Revert. Saying she doesn't believe in the sunnah. The Arabs made up the sunnah in order to put black people down. So I don't believe in the sunnah. Because there are some hadith that are racist. There are some hadith that people made up that are racist. Some hadith that people made up that talk bad about the different madhabs. One hadith said that the Prophet said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there is a man who is more rougher, more tougher, more astray than the Dajjal. And then they said, who is he, Ya Rasulullah? He said, his name is Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i. Some Hanafi person made that up because they used to be at war with each other, the Hanafis and the Shafi'i. So he made that up to create that. The Prophet never said that about Al-Imam al-Shafi'i. So yes, there are some fabricated hadith that show racism. Fabricated. Abbas, the uncle of the Prophet, was walking with a bunch of food. Prophet Muhammad said, where you going with that food? He said, I'm going to go give it to the Habashis, the Ethiopians who are staying in the masjid. They came to visit on the day of the Eid. I'm going to go give it to them. Give it to them. Prophet Muhammad said, yes, yes, hurry, hurry. Because those Zinjis, those Zanuj, When they are hungry, they start stealing. So a person who has no knowledge, he has no knowledge. He thinks every hadith is true. No, they're fabricated hadith and they're true hadith. So here the revert girl comes say, I don't want any hadith. Okay, but I see you telling your husband, buy me a new Eid clothes, new Eid shoes, new Eid jilbab. Where's the Eid at in the Quran? Where is Salatul Eid in the Quran? Somebody tell me. May my mother, my father be sacrificed. You will never be able to show me an ayat in the Quran clearly telling us Salatul Eid, seven takbirs, then five takbirs, and then you read this and you read that. Where is that? So guys, give life to the Eid. I remember years ago, this masjid, the Eid was always in the masjid, always in the masjid. And then alhamdulillah, growth and development. Now the people are saying, people of the Sunni here say, hey, the right, correct place to do the Eid is in the Musalla. So we're going to go to the Musalla. But are we those kind of people who, if it's very cold or if it's raining, we're going to say, let's do the Sunnah and still go to the Musalla and get rain on our head? We're going to say, no. We got a contingent plan, a black backup plan. If there's rain out there, if there's rain out there, we're going to be here. We do two jamaats here if it's rain out there. But you'll get, inshallah, the information about that. What I'm encouraging you to do, though, learn about the Eid and what to do. Eat before you go to the Eid. Eat before you go. Show the people you're not fasting. Go one way, down one street, and come back another street, another way. And let this be a day where you husbands are real gentle and easy with your wives and your kids. Prophet Muhammad was lying down on the bed, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with his back towards the wall. His wife was very young, Aisha. She was with two of her friends, and they were playing and singing. They were playing and singing. And one of them said in the song that we have a Nabi that knows what's going to happen tomorrow. Prophet Muhammad stood up and said, hey, don't say that. Keep playing and singing, but don't say that. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. He stopped it. So he laid back down, facing the wall. Abu Bakr came in. And Abu Bakr said, Amazamir fi bayt zaman mazamir al-shaytan fi bayt Rasulillah. Are the flutes of shaytan in the house of Rasulillah? Little girls singing songs to stop them. Rasulullah got up. He said, Abu Bakr, every group of people have an Eid. And this is our Eid. And the Eid is a day of eating and drinking. Eid is a day of party. A party within the confines. Stay away from Birmingham. Stay away from Birmingham, a street called Lady Pool Road. On the 9th, the Eid is tomorrow. This is one of the worst things that I've ever seen from the Pakistani community. And I'm not against Pakistanis. I'm telling you, one of the worst things that I've seen from the Pakistani community in Birmingham, in Manchester, is the way their culture tells them to do on the day of the night of the Eid. They turn the music up. The youngsters drive down the street. It's a lot of traffic. They rent expensive cars just to show off. Smoking, screaming, getting high, meeting girls. It's crazy. You say, hey, did you fast 29, 30 days to throw it all out the window like that? And then on this day, how many of you heard of the Mardi Gras? The Mardi Gras in Louisiana, New Orleans. They have this party where the people march down the street. They wear beads, necklaces with beads, and they put masks on. You ever saw them do that in America? And what they do is, they took this from kufr. They believe that the dead souls come back. So they hide their faces, and you're allowed to do anything and everything you want to do. And even the police are there. Plainclothesmen police. They allow the people to do. You just can't go crazy. You can't have a gun and you can't stab people. But you can have fahisha in the street. You can smoke. You can drink. You can do whatever you want. It's like Mardi Gras in Birmingham on that day. So do the Eid. We're going to wind this up, inshallah. From what we have to do, guys, it's very, very important, is after Ramadan, we have to make up the days that you missed in Ramadan. You have to make up those days. The sisters, start making up the days. Brothers, start making up the days. You missed a day because you were sick. You missed a day because you were traveling. You missed a day for whatever legitimate religious reason. After Ramadan, one of the main focus is your Ramadan is not complete until you pay Zakatul Fitr. Your Ramadan is suspended. Your Ramadan is not complete until you made up all the days of Ramadan. If you owe days, your Ramadan is not complete. And those of us who didn't fast throughout the years, you didn't make days up from 3, 4, 5, 6 Ramadans ago. You should be one of those people who fast every Mondays and Thursdays because your Ramadan is not complete. Sometimes it's not complete because we did mistakes in it. So you give zakat to fitr and that purifies it. And sometimes it's not complete because you just didn't do it. So you have to make up the days. Lastly, well not lastly, we have to do our best to try to do the Shawwal. 6 days of Shawwal. The Nabi mentioned sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Sama Ramadan wa tba'ahu sittan min Shawwal kana kasawm al-dahr. Anyone who fasted and he completed the month of Ramadan and then he followed that up with 6 days from Shawwal, he will get the reward like he fasted the whole lifetime. But you have to complete Ramadan first. So if the lady broke off days from Ramadan, she can't fast 6 days of Shawwal. If she fasts 6 days of Shawwal, those go towards her Ramadan. But there are some scholars that said, some scholars did say, no. As long as the person makes 6 fasts in the month of Shawwal, even if they're making up those days, they still count. Because it's Shawwal. But the strongest opinion that leaves you with no doubt is if you make up all of the days. Because the hadith said, من صام رمضان ثم أتبعه. Anybody who fasts Ramadan, and then he followed it up with 6. So you have 26 days, 23 days. You didn't fast Ramadan yet. You only have 24 days, 23, 25 days. You didn't complete Ramadan. He said, who fasted Ramadan, finish it. Other scholars said, no. They fasted what was there to fast in Ramadan. Now Ramadan is not in there anymore. They did what they had to do. So even if they have some more days, just do it in Shawwal. So if you keep your Ramadan days all together, inshallah, there will be no khilaf concerning that. Last thing that we want to mention is the hadith of the Nabi. We gave a khutbah using this hadith last year. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّ فِي الْجَنَّةِ غُرَفَ يُرَى ظَاهِرُهَا مِنْ بَاطِنِهَا وَبَاطِنُهَا مِنْ ظَاهِرِهَا أَعَدَّهَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى لِمَنْ أَطْعَمَ الطَّعَامُ وَأَلَالَ الطَّعَامُ وَتَابَ الصِّيَامُ وَصَلَّ بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّاسِ نِيَامُ. Verily in the Jannah, there are some rooms that Allah has prepared. The inside of the rooms can be seen from the outside, and the outside can be seen from the inside. Allah has prepared these rooms for those people who do 4 things. They feed people food. They calm down in their speech. They talk nice to people. Number 3, they follow fasting up with fasting. And number 4, they pray during the night prayer. And all 4 of these things are things we did in the month of Ramadan. So after Ramadan, we should continue to feed people like we were breaking people's fast in Ramadan, like we were bringing monthly food. It's from the best deeds to feed people. Also, in Ramadan, if someone was arguing with you, we would say, I'm fasting. I'm not going to reciprocate ignorance with ignorance. So talk nicely with people. Don't argue with people, even after Ramadan. While we learn in Ramadan, and we follow fasting up with fasting. After you finish Ramadan, do Shawwal, do Mondays and Thursdays, do the last 3 white days in the middle. And number 4, they pray during the nighttime, like in Ramadan, Taraweeh. So we shouldn't stop doing all of those good things that we were doing in Ramadan. Ramadan taught us don't eat so much. So continue to be like that. Don't eat a lot. Get some discipline in your life. Ramadan taught us, don't look, lower your gaze, watch what you say, don't lie. Ramadan taught us, don't waste time watching this, watching that, listening to this, listening to that. We're trying to be better people. One of the reasons Ramadan has been legislated, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, in the hopes that you have a taqwa. So all of these things, reading the Quran, الصَّدَقَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, praying in the masjid, coming to the masjid, Everybody here has come to the masjid more in the month of Ramadan. Everybody. So now after Ramadan, it's not time to stop. So Allah has prepared these particular rooms in the Jannah. And Ikhwani, I'm going to tell you guys something. You should go back, inshallah, to the internet and just put on the internet, put in the Google, the description of Jannah. The description of Jannah. That's a khutbah, a dars that has to be given. You know how the Prophet talked about the paradise, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said that the Jannah has 8 doors. One of the doors is called Ar-Riyan. Only the people who fast are going to get in that door. So we know Jannah has 8 doors. Fasters can get through one of those doors. Jannah has different levels, 100 levels, and even more than that. Prophet Muhammad said about the Jannah that the soil, the dirt in the Jannah, is made out of white powder that is musk, nice smell, and the coral, you know, the walls on the side, they're made out of pearls, and they're made out of all kind of like expensive diamonds. You know how we're expensive jewels. Our homes that we have, our homes. You have to put bricks in it, you have to put mortar in it, you have to put sheetrock, drywall, wood. Prophet Muhammad said the Jannah, in the Jannah is what no eyes have ever seen and what no ears have ever heard and no human being has even contemplated. He said that the trees of the Jannah, the trunks of the trees are made out of gold. He said there's a souk in the Jannah, a souk. The people who go to that souk, they go on Friday. Whoever goes to that souk on Friday, the northern wind comes and it blows in their face and it blows their thobes. When they come back to their families, their wives, their families, not only their wives, their families say to the men when they come back, you look more beautiful today than you did yesterday before you went to the souk. And the husband would say to his family, and all of you look more beautiful. And that's every day for eternity. Prophet Muhammad said, Yawm al-Qiyamah, a ram is going to be brought. A ram. And he's going to be slaughtered. And that ram is going to be death. Allah will say, no death after today. Nobody's going to die after today. If you in the hellfire, you in there. You in the Jannah, you in there forever. So every Friday until eternity, they get more beautiful until there's no end. Now the person sits there and he says, how is that? Because you're thinking about the build of the dunya. The guy who comes and builds this stuff and the stuff that we use to build, Allah builds from what you don't even know. He said that the homes of the believers in the Jannah, their house is made out of a carved out pearl, and it would be 600 miles, one house. And they'll have multiple families. They're so big that this family of his won't see them, and they won't see them, and they won't see them. So there'll be no jealousy. There will be no fighting. When he goes to see them, he finishes. He goes to see them. He finishes. He goes to see them. He finishes. He goes to see them. And they, because this thing is so big, they don't see each other. There's not that thing where you have multiple wives here, and she's saying, who's going to sit in the front seat going to the Eid? She was in the front seat last time. And the man is driving to him, and he's driving, he says, Jesus Christ! Because they're doing his head. And Jannah is not like that. It's nothing but love and sakina. So wallahi, ikhwani, I had this in my mind. I said, you know, Abu, you should tell these people about Al-Jannah, the day of the Eid, and the hellfire. Allah said about the kuffar, لَنُزِيدَنَّكُمْ الْعَذَابِ. We're going to increase you in punishment every day, more and more and more and more and more forever. So the question or the point here is, why would we give up the Jannah for this stuff right here? Why? He has a 2-bedroom house, 3-bedroom house, And for that 2-3 bedroom house, he'd do anything just to have a 2-bedroom house, 3-bedroom house. That house does not compare to Jannah. His wife, his kids, whatever, his car, doesn't compare. So why would we fast all of these days in Ramadan? And then after Ramadan, we forget what we were fasting for. We forget what we were created for. We forget what we were put here for. We have been put in this place to try to get to Jannah. You know, there are a lot of things about Jannah. A lot. I didn't prepare it. If I really researched it, and I bring you some stuff that I would think what you say, wow. And it is what no eyes have ever seen, no ears have ever heard. But you know what the greatest reward is in Al-Jannah? The greatest reward is looking at Allah. وَجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاظِرَةٌ إِلَى رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ Allah will come to the people of Jannah, have them come to Him, and He will say, hey, people of the Jannah, is there anything else you people want? And it's everything they want. They're going to say, oh, our Lord, you brighten our faces. You gave us all of this. We don't want anything. Allah will say, no, there's one thing that remains. And then He will remove the hijab that exists between Him and His creation. And when they see the face of Allah, they're going to fall down in prostration. The importance of tawheed. لَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ إِلَّا لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءٌ وَلَا شَكُورًا We feed you because we want to see the face of Allah. We feed you لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ with ikhlas. I'm not feeding you so that I can say, look, I brought the food every day in Ramadan. I'm feeding you because I want to see the face of Allah يوم القيامة. I'm an administrator in this masjid helping Islam go forward because I want to see the face of Allah يوم القيامة. I want all this stuff in the Jannah. Then don't, I say this to you, I say to myself, and completeness is only from Allah, with Allah, don't sell Allah's ayat for a miserable price. أَتَسْتَبْدِلُونَ الَّذِي هُوَ أَدْنَى بِالَّذِي هُوَ خَيْرٌ Do you people choose what is lesser over that which is greater? That which is greater? So we ask Allah in these few minutes that remain, another day is gone. 27 days of Ramadan gone. Khalas. 27 days. We have 2 or 3 more days remaining. Tuesday or Wednesday. Either that will be the Eid. Those of you who are in itikaf, I don't know if you have itikaf here. Those of you, try to stay in the masjid as much as you possibly can, looking for Laylatul Qadr. It's better than 1,000 months. If you catch that day or that night, al-fawz, al-najat, you are successful. So be cognizant and be wary. The shaytan al-rajim, Iblis, he wants to rip us off, man. He wants to rip us off with losing our temper, with wasting time, with becoming lethargic and relaxing and wasting time. Don't be like that. May Allah Azza wa Jalla, ikhwani, make it easy for us and make it easy for you. Hadha wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala nabiyyina subhanaka allahumma wa bihamdika wa ashadu an la ilaha illa ant astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayka. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.